Thank you. First of all, thank you very much for asking very many questions this morning. I really appreciate it. It really helps me structure what I'm going to say. And I also know that we ran on a little bit, and so we'll make sure that doesn't happen because there's a finite amount that we can all listen to, and I'm grateful for your attention. So in the morning we had, I would say, a reasonably philosophical account, and I'm concerned somewhat about two things. One is that it's been at too high a level philosophically, and so people who are already engaging with the issues of coarse graining know exactly what they want to know and they want to talk about it, but others may not yet have as deep a sense about what coarse graining can do for you. I'm also concerned, just came up with lunch, that some terms are used differently in different fields. So one term that came up that I was using rather sloppily was the phrase aggregation, which I was using interchangeably with coarse graining. And so David mentioned this to me, that one might think of aggregation as going from a system with one person to going with a system with, let's say, 10 people. And that's not what I intended to say. Aggregation, let's not use that word again, and let's just focus on the word coarse graining. And what that means is you have a big system with many, many degrees of freedom. So imagine the 64 households, right, that have true to the 64 possible configurations of paying and not paying their mortgage. You have an enormous number of degrees of freedom, and you coarse grain them to come up with a description that's much simpler. So if the word aggregation tripped you up, I will do my best not to use it, and you're welcome to yell at me or solve this Rubik's Cube if it displeases you. What I'd like to do now is give you a really explicit example of coarse graining in the social and biological sciences, and it's going to be explicit in terms of mathematics, so we'll do some mathematics, and in fact, we'll do a little bit of group theory. So this is a group, right? The Rubik's Cube is a group, right? We'll talk about what that means. And we'll talk about how group theory can allow you to coarse grain a computational or information processing system. I know Cameron and I have both been fascinated with the theorem that allows you to do this. We've also become increasingly skeptical about it over the year. And so, whereas last year when I presented this theorem, it was in a sort of triumphant fashion, now when I show you how to coarse grain one of these inhomogeneous systems, it may be less triumphant and more critical. And that's okay too, because we have to destroy things as well as to create them, as we know from evolution, I suppose. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to introduce this explicit coarse graining procedure. And what we're going to do is we're going to be coarse graining finite state machines. What I'll do is I'll just remind you what finite state machines are, and I'll also remind you what finite state machines look like when they're used to describe a real-world system. And it's funny because when I presented in the first talk I was happy to get to do, I talked about how, isn't it amazing that Wikipedia is not a finite state machine? And I think the consensus in the audience was, well, yeah, sure, of course not. But it's also worth noticing that in many, many cases in biological systems especially, modeling these systems as finite state machines is almost ubiquitous. And that's part because the difficulty of modeling anything more sophisticated is it's just too hard. Fitting a context-free grammar is too hard. So we are, to a certain extent, stuck at the top level, right, the sort of threshold of the really interesting computational phenomena, such as the context-free and context-sensitive languages. And where we're focused and where we're stuck in a lot of our modeling is here at the level of the regular languages. And so you know, just to remind you, you've seen the ABBA machine before, right? That these regular languages can be modeled by a system of states and transitions between states. That when you transcend the boundaries of the regular languages, you can go up in the Chomsky hierarchy, and again, I'd be remiss if I didn't point out that the Chomsky hierarchy is just one way to talk about a nested partial order on systems of increasing computational complexity. One thing I may not have made clear, and so I'd like to do it, and I have a nice example, is how regular grammars, how finite state machines actually model real-world phenomena. So this is an example from Numerical Recipes. This is my advisor's advisor, so my grand advisor, Bill Kress, who wrote this. And in fact, interestingly, Bill came out of physics, and so the first two editions of Numerical Recipes did not have any of these kinds of modeling chapters. It was much more physics-focused. But Bill is now a biologist at Texas, and so we have to learn hidden Markov models. So I was very disappointed when I had to learn these, because my old edition didn't have them. So here's a hidden Markov model of a teenager. So presumably you all have a teenager at home. It's called teen life, right? And your teen, should you either be or have one, has, in this case, 5 internal states, right? And he makes transitions between these states. And the probability of making the transitions is listed there as sort of, for example, the transition between eating and studying is approximately 10%. Right? Wait, slowly sinking in here, right? Okay, so this is a hidden Markov model or a regular grammar model of a teenager, right? Often what happens is you don't have information about the hidden underlying states, right? So for example, when the teen is hanging out, okay, there is a non-zero probability, actually, oddly, he doesn't say I'm studying. So when he's talking on the phone, there's a non-zero probability that he will actually yell at you, I'm studying. Okay? So not only, okay, do you have stochastic transitions between these states, the underlying states of the teen, right, but you also have imperfect knowledge about which states the teen is in. Okay? You guys are finding this much funnier than I found when I saw this version. Right? So here's your modeling problem, right? Observe is a string of behaviors that your teen is producing, right? So essentially yelling at you continuously, writing different bits of information about what they're doing, right? So in a more serious case, for example, the observed behavior might be what you're doing in a particular social system, such as Wikipedia, the kind of edits the system is making, right? It can be the notes in a Bach fugue, as we'll see. And then your job is, given this observed string of behaviors, can you model the system with a finite number of hidden internal states, transitions between them, and probabilities of emitting the observed behaviors that are conditional upon being in one state versus another? So that's the underlying modeling problem. It's not a trivial one, right? There's an enormous number of parameters. So you have n states, you have an m by n matrix for all the transitions. You have m observed behaviors for each state. You then have to specify the probability of emitting a certain symbol or not. Right? It turns out there is actually a nice way to solve this problem without searching the entire space. It's called the Faust-Laum re-estimation algorithm. It's extremely common in this variety of expectation maximization algorithm. If you look, if you Google it, you will find everything you want to know about it. I won't go into the details here. It's an essentially Bayesian algorithm. So if you remember from the statistics lectures, what that means is you have a model, okay, and you want to fit a model to the data. So you want to ask, what's the most likely model given the observed data? And you turn that around, and you say, what's the most likely thing this model will emit, and how close is it to the observed data? Okay. And it turns out that you can guess a bad model and iterate your solution until you find a good one, and it will converge. So that's a very nice feature of this system. So just to show how this works, and to show the limitations of it, I built a finite state machine to model the unfinished fugue of J.S. Bach, the last member of the Art of Fugue, Contrapuntis 14. So what I'll do is I'll play, it's a MIDI file, so it won't be very nice, but I'll play the complete fugue, which has 4 voices, just so you can hear what it sounds like. Structure there. What I'll do, because there are many states of that system, so if you have 4 voices and they can range over, let's say, 4 octaves, right, you have an enormous number of possible states because each voice has, let us say, 12 times 4, 48 possible states it can be in, 49 if you include silence. So you have 49 to the 4 possible emitted symbols, okay, for all the possible chords. What I'll do is I'll simplify it. What I'll do is I'll take out most of the structure, I'll just consider the top 2 voices. And not only that, but I'll modulo the octave. So all of the notes will be constrained to be within 1 octave. So it will not sound as beautiful, but it will still hopefully sound harmonious. So that's the art of fugue. Now, as you can see, the top two voices as recreated by a 12-state hidden Markov model. Okay? So the idea is we have a regular grammar, right? It's producing the behavioral patterns that Bach, in some sense, wrote down. And so this can potentially generate a fugue of infinite length, right? And what it's doing is it's drawing sentences from the space of possible sentences according to some probability distribution that it's learned by watching the original fugue itself. So there are many problems here. For example, right, the fugue is not stationary. Okay, the fugue begins at a unique point, right, where only one voice is playing. Whereas the hidden Markov model, for full example, tell you what the equilibrium fugue distribution is. So we're going to play, hopefully this will work, the hidden Markov model, one realization, one string from the language, the probabilistic language of Bach. That's probably the data. And so you can see, this is really just broken down into a time series here. Soprano, alto, tenor, bass, and just the numbers associated with the semitones above what we'll see.
So you understand? What did you say? There are four forces.
There are four voices.
And then I see these numbers, and then in the lowest, what's the lowest line that you have?
Oh, that T there, so this is just a clip from the paper that gave me the data. That T there is a measure number. Yeah, that's measured 3,000. Okay, so. So. I didn't write it. So, there's something missing from the hidden Markov model or regular grammar model of Bach's genius. And what is missing? There are many things that are missing, of course, and I think it's instructive to describe or try to put your finger on exactly what's missing. So one thing you notice, for example, is that there's not too much disharmony, okay? But what's missing are the longer range structures, okay? For example, there's no rhythmic patterning that's so obvious in the original forms, or the original piece. There's no logic, there's no long range logic to why we're hearing a somewhat, let's say, a minor fourth, I don't know music, why we're hearing a certain kind of chord that we know should resolve in a certain way, or if it doesn't, it should resolve in a tricky way. And none of that happens, so all that's gone. What we're left with are some very short timescale phenomena, somewhere around here, somewhere between pitch, which happens at sort of the scale of a tenth of a second, right, up to rhythm, right, which happens about a second. So we have some of the short-scale rhythms, right, sort of ratios of semi-quavers to quavers and so forth. But what we're certainly missing is the melody. There's no melody here. The hidden Markov model, the regular grammar, doesn't capture that feature of the system. And it certainly doesn't capture the large-scale forms. If you know fugues, there's lots of wonderful patterns. This is in Hofstadter's book, but lots of wonderful patterns, which is the inversion of the theme, right? And so the idea that there might be bracketed structures, context-free structures, right, is you could not account for. So another way to ask is, where does a fully convincing art of fugue lie? Okay, at what level of computational complexity do we have to model the fugue? So you might ask, for example, right, are the nested structures that you see, okay, does that require context-free grammar to model? Okay, another thing you might ask, right, sort of, are the essential features of the art of fugue Turing complete? Right? Do you actually require a Turing machine to model successfully? So that's a story about the failures of regular grammars to model what you want them to model. And I think it's instructive to keep it in mind when, as will probably happen, you come to build hidden Markov models of systems that you care about. Hidden Markov models actually often turn out to be extremely predictive. And so they're favorites of finite state machines. Finite state machines are favorites in machine learning. But what they're also missing is so obvious what they're missing in, for example, reproducing the art of fugue. And so I think it's instructive to think about when someone shows you a hidden Markov model, let's say, of animal behavior, or when someone shows you a hidden Markov model of protein structure, right? So it's moving along, trying to tell you if the sequence of amino acids is going to have a purpose, going to produce a protein that has a certain functional role. So you know at this point that they fail. And in fact, the question is not perhaps when did or why do they fail, or do they fail, but when they fail, what level of system you're trying to model data. So that said, we will now talk about coarse graining finite state machines. And so we'll spend a lot of time in the next maybe 10 minutes describing the connection between the finite state machines and group theory. And what we'll do is we'll discover that because of this relationship between the finite state machines and the groups, okay, which are mathematical objects, we can import a lot of theorems from group theory into the study of empirical systems. And one of the theorems that we'll be allowed to import, called the Crone-Rhodes theorem, will give us a story about how to coarse grain a finite state machine. Okay. So, what's a group? Let me give you an example. Let's say you have a system of three cards, okay? And they're ordered 1, 2, and 3. So I have three cards like this. Now, I can take the top card, 1, and I can put it on the bottom of the deck. Okay? So now I get a new system, okay? I've done an operation, okay, to the system, and instead of 1, 2, 3, my cards are now 2, 3, 1. Okay? So we'll call that cycle left, L. Okay? We'll do this again. We get 3, 1, 2. Okay? Upon operating on the system with this L operator. Okay? And you can see what happens now if I do this one more time, I get back up to the top. Right? So if I take the 3 card, put it all the way on the bottom, okay, I get 1, 2, 3. This is not very simple card tricks. This does not exhaust all the possible configurations of that 3-card system, right? There are more than 3 potential states that the cards can be in, right? And in particular, one way to access those additional states is to invoke the swap operation, which we'll call S. And the swap operation takes the bottom 2 cards and swaps them, okay? Hence its cunning name. 1, 3, 2. 2, 1, 3. And 3, 2, 1. Okay? So this new operation that we do on the system, this new thing we do to the underlying microstate of the system allows us to access a whole new range of possible configurations. And you'll notice also, if I've done this correctly, and every time I do this, I'm always kind of amazed, that of course I can apply the left cycle operator, right, to these states just as well as these states. But it goes in the opposite direction. So if I take 2 and put it on the bottom, I get 1, 3, 2, which goes like this. If I take 1 and put it on the bottom, I get 3, 2, 1. Okay? Like this. And similarly, like that. So you can see this very simple three-state, or rather, 3-card system, right, has an enormous structure to it, which is quite profound, right? Think about it this way, right? Let's say that I am a steward in the airplane. And if you take the Southwest and fly on the Southwest, sometimes you have a layover. And they're always very concerned because they don't want you, if you're staying on the plane, right, stay in your seat so we can count you. We need to count you because if you get off the plane, it's going to be a huge hassle, right? 9/11, serious stuff. So let's imagine, okay, we had this whole system here, okay? And every time I'm walking through the aisle, every time I see a passenger, I hit the left swap button, or the left cycle button. I start in this state here, let's say, and I hit the left cycle once, twice, and I'm allowed to count. In fact, I'm allowed to count up to 3. And if I hit the left cycle too many times, I get back to where I started. So I'm counting the passengers modulo 3. Okay. So now imagine I count the passengers modulo 3, and I get to the end of the aisle. Okay. I preserve my cards in that configuration. Okay. And now I have to verify before we take off that all the passengers are back. Okay, that all the people who are meant to be on the plane are still on the plane. Well, how do I do this? I hit the swap button. Okay, so I've counted this way. Okay, now I hit the swap button, and then I go back and I hit the L button again. And I count backwards. And if the number of passengers on the plane is the same as before, at least modulo 3, I should get back to the original state. And if I haven't, I know that there's a problem. Okay? So this is how a group we've represented by 3 cards allows us to model not only counting modulo some number, okay, but also counting down again, right? And so this is how you might imagine some simple biological system representing numbers internally, not only representing numbers, but representing operations that you can do on numbers. Are there any questions about groups? Okay, so the Rubik's Cube is a group, right? Okay, and the fundamental mathematical definition of a group is very simple, right? It says I have operations, L's, in this case, S's, right? I have many different operations I can do here, right, on the Rubik's Cube, okay? The operations don't necessarily commute, okay? So if I do one and then the other, it's not the same as doing the second and then the first, right? And we know this in the Rubik's Cube, that, right, is not equivalent to that, I think. I'm terrible at groups. But we know that the final thing is about a group is that it's always reversible. Okay? So there's a sequence of operations. Any sequence of operations has an inverse. Okay? And sometimes the inverse can be very hard to find. So for example, when I bought this cube, it was perfectly solved. Right? They sell it to you solved. Right? And then over the course of 2 years, I sit around and just kind of fiddle with it because I don't want to think too hard. So I don't try and solve it, I'm just fiddling with it. I'm putting lots of operations onto this Rubik's Cube. Okay? There must exist a sequence of operations that invert what I did. Okay? I might not be able to find it, but somebody apparently was. Right? So that's what it means to solve the Rubik's Cube. It's essentially to discover the sequence of operations that are the inverse to the operations that were done since the cube was purchased. Okay? So groups in this case seem quite trivial. Right? I'm counting up and down. Right? But the complexity of groups can become extreme. Okay? Like you notice another thing about this system, and that's the way it breaks down, okay, into two subsystems. Right? And this will be the key part, okay, of the coarse graining operation. Right? Notice, let's say, of course, swap has its inverse like this. This is in fact a swap. Swap is its own inverse. If I'm unable to perceive the difference between these three states and these three states, right? If the way I build my theory is insensitive to those differences in microstructure, okay, I can still talk about the computational properties of the system, except the computational properties are much simpler. Instead of counting 1, 2, 3, and also being able to cycle back and forth 1, 2, like this, okay, if I coarse grain the system in this way, I still get a valid group, it's just a much simpler one. Okay? It's a group that counts odd versus even. So that's the essential story that we'll be telling. And it's a story about the hierarchical decomposition of a finite state machine. So hopefully from this point, right, you've seen that I've represented this group in a way that looks like a finite state machine. I have internal states, okay? And the system has to have enough structure to be able to maintain and distinguish those internal states. Right? And then I have transitions. Okay? And of course, if you went back to the team life example, there you would have a group. You'd have a combination of groups. So, in telling the story about how I took this counter here, lumped it into one, and this counter here, and lumped it into one, I told a story about coarse graining. Notice that I could have had some really bad coarse graining stories. I could have unified these two states, and then these states here, okay? And if I had done that, I would no longer get a valid finite state machine. I would have lumped together states that have different computational properties, right? And I would not get a simpler, higher order finite state machine. It would be somewhat mysterious, okay? It would behave in ways that I couldn't predict, okay? Another way to put it is the microstructures matter. I've averaged in the wrong way. And so what I think is an equivalence class, a coarse grain state that has the same computational properties, actually secretly it matters who's inside. So that would be a failure of the coarse graining process. Here's just another example of what you can do in coarse graining. So let's go over here. Let's have an even simpler machine, a machine that counts 1, 2, 3, this is sort of like a subset. Well, that machine counts to 3, this machine counts to 4. Okay? And what I can do is break it into a hierarchical decomposition of two machines that both count to two. Okay? The first machine gets the counter signal. Right, so someone hits the button on the machine. The first machine gets the counter signal and counts odds versus evens. The second machine counts the higher order bit. Okay? So what's magical about this is that, at least in the case of groups, the way the system breaks down, these higher order descriptions where I had some complicated group, okay, with three cards that had counters that were reversing each other, okay, and that decomposes into two things. One, an odd versus even counter that modulates the behavior of the lower level count to three counter. Okay, that way I broke the system down, there's actually a unique way to do so. And in fact, there's a very small, or at least relatively small, number of groups that you can break down. In fact, they're all listed here in the Atlas of Finite Groups. Okay. So what that means is that when you take a finite state machine that is a group, okay, so every operation is an inverse, you take a finite state machine that's a group, okay, you can always break it down in this way into a small number of finite groups that are listed in the categorization that was begun in the 19th century and finished in 2004, and some of the groups are extremely complicated. So there's something called the monster group, right? Which is even bigger. So this, by the way, this is not actually a simple group. So if I drew all the possible states of this Rubik's Cube, okay, I could actually decompose it into the product, okay, of these smaller simple groups. Yes, so the technical definition of a simple group is a group that has no normal subgroup. Okay. In this case here, the way to think about it, so I would say, go read about normal subgroups to get the technical definition. But what's happening here is that this movement from here to here, moving from this set of states to this set of states, okay, preserves the underlying group structure, except it's allowed to modulate the action of the other letters. Okay. So when I go from here to here, okay, this L cycles in a different direction. Okay.
So is that what prevented you from grouping, say, the first row and then the second row? And then the
first row? Actually, you could also decompose it that way. Okay. Yes. But you couldn't sort of pick this guy and this guy and this guy to be one normal subgroup. It's not normal. And what that means is if you act on elements in that group with the same letter, okay, they don't respect the higher level coarse grading, right? So to put it another way, let's follow this through. This is a good point. So consider where I group them like this, into this class and this class, okay? So we'll call it state A and state B, okay? When state A receives an L signal, right, okay, it doesn't change. This state goes to this state, because they're both in state A. So the coarse grading respects the underlying group structure, and similarly for state B, right? And similarly, for every state here, if I hit it with a swap, they all go to state B, right? So now let's take a bad coarse grain, okay? Right? So now, when I hit this with an L, right? Let's say I take this one here and I hit it with an L, it goes outside, call this state A prime. It goes outside of state A prime. But when I hit this with an L, it stays in state A prime. Okay? And so that's a bad coarse grain, right? And what it means is if I try to build a theory, okay, based on the behaviors of states A and B, I have a chance at succeeding. Because the environmental inputs may shuffle around people within the equivalence class, but they won't break up that equivalence class into separate parts. Whereas if I chose the other coarse grain state A prime, it would break it up. Okay? And so now someone would say, well, your theory's not predictive yet. It's not explaining what's going on because there's two systems with the same coarse grain state do not behave in the same way under that operation. If you look at the finite state machines here, you'll notice that some operations are not reversible. Okay? Okay. So unlike the Rubik's Cube, it's possible to break a finite state machine. And you know this, right? Because if you hit, say, A with A and then B, you get trapped in this subspace. Right? There's an irreversible process here. And so we know from the statistics lectures, right, that irreversibility is associated with a decrease in entropy and all sorts of wonderful statistical properties. What's important for us is not those stochastic aspects, but just the fact that you can't get out. There's no inverse. And so a generic finite state machine will not be a group. And because of that, for a very long time, it was believed that these kinds of coarse graining operations that are so beautiful, okay, in the case of group structures, where every group you can think of decomposes, right, into a bible of a small number of simple groups, okay, no one thought that that would work. It turns out, surprisingly enough, that you can extend the theory. And not only can you decompose groups into these coarse-grained sort of equivalence classes, but even if there are irreversible operations, you can do so. And in fact, the only thing you have to add to your toolbox, in addition to group operations, right, that are contained in the simple groups, is what are called these pure resets, where everyone gets sent to the same state. So a pure reset is something you may be familiar with if you hit Control C on your computer enough. Right? If you've done something bad, right? Just hit Control C enough and eventually you go to some default state. Right? And Control C has no inverse. Right? You can't control unsee and get back to your Microsoft Word file. Right? Or your laser shoot ladder game or whatever.
Oh my god.
So you have to include the pure resets in your coarse grain model. And so this theorem was proved by two guys, Cronin and Rhodes. And so I know Cameron knows this story, but Cronin and Rhodes were both graduate students. One was at Harvard, one was at MIT. Together, they thought this theorem could be proved. Okay? Just to be clear, the theorem is that there exists a way to coarse grain any finite state machine into a hierarchical set, okay, of systems. In the same way, for example, if we coarse grain, okay, the counter to 4 into a hierarchy. The top level just counts even versus odd, and the bottom level works out the details about whether you counted up to 4 or 1 or 3 or 1. And so what they proved was that even for an arbitrary finite state machine with irreversible operations, the decomposition went ahead, and you just had to add one more thing, and that was the pure resets. So John Rhodes is retired now from Berkeley. He's a very interesting man. He wrote a book called Applications of Automata and with her automata theory with applications too. There's a long list of things that he applies to in his book. And he begins with applying it to biochemical systems. Right? So you can imagine, for example, thinking of a metabolic cycle as a finite state machine. Okay? Where you take some chemical, some enzyme, and produce transformations on it depending upon the environment the cell finds itself in. So he starts with sort of biochemical examples and he ends up diagnosing schizophrenia. So, at some point, it fails. How to actually do this decomposition is non-trivial. And in fact, it turns out there are many competing ways to perform the decomposition. Another way to put it is there is not a unique way to do so. Cronin and Rhodes, when they proved their theorem, actually had a way to do the decomposition that was extraordinarily inefficient. It produced many, many levels that were not necessary for the description of the machine. They were only interested in an existence group. And over the course, from when they started the theorem, when the theorem was first proven in the 60s, it percolated through the computer science literature, and no one really understood it. And in fact, probably for a long time, only Rhodes understood it. And then occasionally somebody would study it and realize something about it and publish a paper, but these papers never really made it out of the outside world. At some point, someone discovered a much more efficient way to compute these equivalence classes, to get a list of equivalence classes that coarse-grained your system appropriately. And that was called the holonomy decomposition. And then in the 1990s and into the 2000s, people actually wrote computer code, okay, that enables you to start with some state machine here, and after some long set of manipulation, coarse-grain it into a hierarchy of machines here. Okay. So now at this point, we're able to do this automatically. So here's an example. So here's the Apple machine again on the left. Okay? And what I've done is the following. Right? I've decomposed it into a hierarchy of machines that are simpler, right? Those machines in particular include all of the simple groups, or at least they're drawn from the list of simple groups. And they also include the pure resets. So I generated that hierarchy, and so schematically it's listed here, right? So I have an input symbol sigma, okay, that's modulating the behavior of these submachines. And then what I did was I just truncated the hierarchy, I just toggled it. Okay? So what I have on the left is a finite state machine, okay? And what I have on the right is the coarse grain finite state machine. So we've now coarse grained an inhomogeneous system. And the idea or hope, right, is that just as we've been able to talk about effective theories by coarse graining on a spatial scale, we can now talk about effective theories through coarse graining on an information processing system. And the problem is that the information processing system doesn't tell us, it's not obvious, which states you should lump together, whereas in the spatial system, it is obvious which states you should lump together. Okay? So you can see, for example, here, that in the coarse grained system, there's this group state here, okay, which can either be in the lower level system D or E. Right? And the higher order effective theory is agnostic about which one it is. Okay? But this system here will describe, will tell you nothing untrue about this lower level system. It just doesn't know all the details.
There's none of the states D and F. So now, actually, there's only one arrow that says how you get from B to G.
Sorry.
To
be clear, C and F are actually members of all the states. So I just didn't write that on this plot. Okay. So in fact, it's B, E, C, F for all of them. Okay. So notice that when you get trapped in the subspace, right, you're just cycling between C and F and you're just going around this loop here. Okay. So the coarse grain system describes those as different states, even though fundamentally they're not in that case. But in order to be consistent, it has to do that. That's how it accounts for the structure, the unusual structure of the organized system. So the one thing we have to add, and this is something that comes up when you try and model systems that have stochasticity, is what do you do if transitions are not necessarily deterministic? And what you model that as is you model that as uncertainty in the environment. And in particular, if a transition is stochastic, right? If what you do when you leave one state to go to another is uncertain, as it is, for example, the team life example, what you do is you model that as a system of you model it as a system of deterministic transitions implemented by a letter whose value you don't know. Okay. And so that stochasticity leads to a time horizon for how much computation you can do. As you keep putting more and more letters into the system, okay, if the transitions are stochastic, you become less and less certain about what state you're in. So I think I'm turning the Rubik's Cube like this, but actually the operation has a stochastic effect. It turns it like this. And as that goes on and on and on, I accumulate more and more uncertainty about what the final state of my system is. And in particular, if there are any resets, if there are any irreversible operations, eventually I will get trapped in one of the subspaces. So noise in computation provides a kind of limit to how much information you can store and actually do useful processing on. It puts a limit, for example, on how high you can count, okay, before you lose track of where the number of people on the Earth is. And that limit actually is quite hard. So you can see here, even for very low noise, 1% error, right, after sort of over 10 steps, you become increasingly uncertain about what actual operation you've done in the system and thus what internal state. So, how does this help us? What does this tell us about building theories of the real world? So this actually is almost exactly parallel to the discussion we had about the aggregation of agents in economics. Let's say we have a single person, a single economic agent. And what he does is he transfers between internal states, it's a finite state machine, like the teenager in Bill Preston's example, right? He transitions between states, in this case, contingent on environment and input. And let's aggregate together all three people. Okay, so we've taken this as only one person, we've aggregated them together, okay? And what we we get is, I won't show it to you, we get a huge finite state machine with 512 possible internal states. Okay. So we've gone from a system with a reasonable number of states to one that we're having trouble describing. Okay. And so then, that's coarse graining. And what we can see is we now have an effective theory for the interactions of those agents, those three agents, which is described now by a Z6 counter and a reset. Is there a question?
Just to be sure, you mentioned earlier that aggregation and coarse grain is the same. In this case, aggregation means coarse grain between different individuals, and coarse grain is the between different states.
Yes, so let's take this really slowly, right? So what I've done is I have one machine, okay? Now I consider an aggregate, let's say. I should have changed the slide at first, but and now I consider a bag. Three of these machines, three interacting people. And I ask, what is the total state of that system? When we're going to specify that state, I have to specify the state of each individual. So just imagine, let's say, all of us are finite state machines, okay? For all finite state machines, and I know all of our internal states, I can produce an incredibly detailed, fine-grained description of the system. If I have a big enough computer, for example, I can simulate the states the system will go through as I hit it with different letters. So that's the aggregation step, right? Just a second, and I'll answer that. Then what I did was I took that system with a huge number of free parameters, or rather, a huge number of degrees of freedom, right? So that's like an agent-based model. And I coarse-grained it using the Kronberg's theorem. And I said, what's the top-level group that describes, or semi-group that describes the underlying transitions? So each of these states here, alpha, delta, gamma, and so forth, each of these states is actually describing a whole set of possible configurations of the system. Okay? But it's a consistent coarse grain. Does that explain it? Does that help?
Yeah.
Okay. It was a question.
When you say you aggregate the three machines, the three machines are independent.
Yes, exactly. Yes. So this is sort of a trivial aggregation. Would be three letters long. Well, so no.
So when you coarse grain, why do you see only one there?
You see two there. There should be A's and B's on that lower level graph. So A's and B's. But let me say what's going on here in explicit detail. So let's just do a very simple counter to three. Right? So when I aggregate three copies of these, I get three individuals. Then I have a state, for example, that looks like A, A, A. And I have a state that looks like A, A, B, and so forth. And I have transitions between those states. Okay? And so I ask, for example, A, 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 in this very simple case, goes to B, B, B under the action of this ladder. Right? And so I have an enormous finite state machine here, which I won't draw all of, which has transitions between the underlying microstates encoded in it. And that's a very large machine.
So my question is, for the last one from AAA to AAB?
There is none. Right? But if you began in this state and you hit it with an A letter, in this case, right, you would go to B, D, so in fact, this machine is disconnected, right? But that's not true in general, especially if you're a reversible operation. Yeah. So this is, in some sense, the exact picture we wanted. We wanted to know what the rule should be when you aggregate small groups to larger groups, okay? One of the things that comes up is the question of how the coarse graining will actually break your system into pieces. Because in order to describe a system in a reduced way, you draw circles, in a sense, around different collections of microstates. But there's no reason, for example, why those connections have to respect the boundaries of the original individual. Okay? So I might have a coarse grain state, okay, that is described in part by this individual's configuration, this one and this one. It's a joint state of a number of people that is, in some sense, going across the boundaries, okay, of the underlying agents. Okay. So this process here, by which you aggregate machines, and notice I haven't put any structure on this system. All that says is, in fact, all the machines are all listening to the same environment. They have no interactions with each other, right? I can put interactions in as long as I can describe this complicated machine. As long as I can describe this complicated machine, I know what a coarse grain is. So one way to think about this process is, if I can build the micro theory, which is accurate at all scales, if I can build that micro theory, I can coarse grain it to get the effective theory. So in this diagram we put up before, okay, we talked about how you flowed from one theory to another under the coarse grain operation. Okay. And this is exactly what you want, and then you get for free in some sense from the semi-group structure of finite state machines. So the last thing I'd like to talk about is what this says about the example that we pulled up much earlier on about the dynamics of it. Because it's something that puzzled me when I was thinking about the relationship between these concepts. Okay? So let's imagine that we have an aggregation, okay, of individual editors. And each individual editor is well modeled by a finite state machine. Okay? Those individual editors combine to produce a microphysical state of the entire Wikipedia system. For example, some of the editors might be in a subspace of their state space that means they're unhappy and unlikely to cooperate. And other editors might be in a cooperative state, and so forth. And so those editors together, okay, combine to make a new finite state machine. Right? Now, when we come to model the behaviors, I'm talking about this schematically here, where you combine editors together, you get a complicated system which you then coarse grain to get a new finite state machine. I'm going to coarse grain that emergent finite state machine further, and all I'm going to do is I'm going to pay attention to whether or not the state of that coarse grain machine leads to a cooperative, okay, or revert edit on the underlying page. Okay. I still get the finite state machine. In some sense, amalgamations of finite state machines coarse grain to other finite state machines. They're renormalizing. Okay? I get a new machine, that's true, but all it is a change in parameters. I don't get novel structure. I don't get novel computational powers coming out. Okay? And what that does, or at least it says to me, is that conflicts with what the data show. Right? The claim was is that this long tail here, this long tail of cooperative edits, which was not exponential, conflicts with the claim that the overall system can be modeled by a finite state machine. We took finite state machines, let us say, amalgamated them, and out the other side we got something that wasn't. Okay? And so I have some data here on this. So let's try and model, just as we model the Bach cube, okay? Let's try and model the Wikipedia system as a hidden Markov model. So for example, I have a very simple hidden Markov model where the overall state of Wikipedia is two states, and there's transitions between them. And what you can see is that it reproduces very well, okay, the low-level cooperation, but it massively underpredicts the existence of these long cooperative events. Okay? As I add more data, I get better at fitting it, but what happens at some point is if I add too many states, I even get worse. Okay? So there's something very strange going on here. Okay? As I try and fit this system, as I find the best fit model, okay, for the dynamics of online social behavior, okay, I get increasingly worse fit for this critical region of long-extended cooperative events. And I don't know what's going on. Okay? The argument I've given you, right, is that if I increasingly amalgamate together copies, even variant copies of a finite state machine, and then coarse grain it, I get a new finite state machine. But that's not what I see in the data. So I have three possibilities. Okay? The first is sort of the Warren Buffett answer. Okay, the Warren Buffett answer is that you have a universality, but you don't have stationarity. Okay? So the system is at any particular point a finite state machine, but it's changing too fast for me to measure it correctly. Okay? That's the first somewhat deflationary answer. Okay? The next one is that the underlying people are not finite state machines. Of course, in general, we know that's true. Right? I'm on a finite state machine, you're on a finite state machine. That's why, for example, the Bach, based on finite state machine analysis, sounds so bad. Right? Because we're able to recognize these long-range patterns that finite state machines, by definition, cannot. Okay? Not only does it mean we're not finite state machines, but somehow, right, that over and aboveness, that complexity that we're able to accomplish, okay, persists in our large-scale organizations. Okay? That somehow the complexity of human behavior on the individual scale percolates upwards, okay, and means that the final machine is no longer, okay, a finite state machine. Our mechanism is not within the basin of attraction of the machines. Finally, I don't quite know how to describe this correctly, but somehow the way the amalgamation happens, the interactions between people, lead to a theory that's not normalizable. So I'm putting these objects together, but the ways in which the individual, these objects are finite state machines, but the ways in which they're interacting, okay, lead to the emergence of properties that cannot be described by the coarse grain system. So coarse grain no longer goes through. There's some feature of the system that doesn't respect the equivalence classes that the coarse grain operation uses. So I don't quite know what this means, but it's the closest I've come to an example of emergence in the real world. It's kind of surprising that it goes down. When you have more and more states, you're now required to fit more and more complicated local behaviors. But in trying to fit those more and more complicated sort of 1-2-3-step interactions, you get increasingly worse at fitting what we call the institutional structures, the long-range dependencies that you find. Yes.
So I think I know the answer to this, but I have some answer anyway. So second ago, your second explanation was that the individuals are not finite state machines, and thus somehow that sophistication percolates up in the sophistication of the large scale system.
Right.
Is there an example of where that's not the case, where the individuals are not finite state machines, but somehow that sophistication does not percolate up?
That's a very good question. Let me give you a simpler answer, which goes back to the stories we're telling about normalization in more physical systems. So for example, consider the skew. Right? So I have an unusual probability distribution with all these non-Gaussian features. Right? But when I coarse grain that system by addition, all those flow away, they go to zero. Right? So the phenomenon of mechanism complexity averaging out, right, persists or exists in many systems. Right? But somehow, it could be the case that it's not true here. Right? That somehow the sort of stupidity of crowds, the delusions of crowds, right, that doesn't go through.
Right?
So that's one explanation. Right? It is also possible to begin with finite state machines, but to get something that is not a finite state machine. But that, to me, is much more serious. I don't have a good account of it. So I put it up there as a lot. Let me just go through where we've been in the last hour. Okay. So we talked about hidden Markov models. We talked about how you have some set of observed behavior, and there exist many powerful algorithms in the literature to model that behavior in the team life story, where you have internal states, in this case internal states of the few, that emit chords with different probabilities and transition to novel states. So we talked about the hidden Markov model of music, and we played an example when we felt it was somewhat dissatisfying. That it didn't, for us, contain a lot of the features that we considered to be essentially musical. And so there, we have an intuition that somehow there's something beyond, okay, the finite state machine model that's encoded in the art of music. And perhaps, for example, that's this parenthesis structure of increasing, sort of, you have one theme here, it has to be paired with another theme over there. Having made a regular grammar model or a finite state machine model, we talked about the map between the finite state machine and the semi-group. Okay? And we showed, first of all, how the groups can be coarse-grained. Okay? So I gave an example of groups here. In fact, this is called the dihedral group. Okay? And the dihedral group, which was represented as shuffling internal microstates, coarse-grains in this very nice way. Into a counter that counts to 3, and a counter that counts to 2, and modulates the underlying behavior. Then we talked about the Kern-Rose theorem, and we showed how this coarse grain can be extended to finite state machines in general. And that allowed us to give an account of how to amalgamate potential states of the system and talk about coarse grain, higher order states, and ask about theories built on them. Which is analogous, okay, to the physical systems case, where you coarse grain, but there it was obvious what to do. It was obvious how to create groups. You just took the neighbors, the spatial neighbors, or the temporal neighbors. And at the end, we had this puzzle, and I don't know how to resolve the puzzle. The puzzle is that somehow, Wikipedia is not showing this coarse grain phenomenon. Okay? When you take, if you imagine Wikipedia to be a huge finite state machine, circle the nodes, okay, that are cooperative, circle the nodes that emit revert, okay, that doesn't reproduce the system, given large, even given large numbers of infinite states. In fact, as you add more states to your fit, the fit gets worse. This long. And the answer, I don't know what the answer is. Yes?
Is that for cooperative edits?
Yes, this is the same graph as in the first lecture. So this is the probability of a fraction of strings longer, of cooperative strings longer than a certain number.
How does a fitting function for this work? Like 100 states?
That's a good question, right? So the algorithm to fit this hidden Markov model is the same one you use to fit the Bach cube, right? It's called the Baumwell free estimation algorithm. Otherwise, it's a variety of an expectation maximization algorithm. And so those have good convergence properties. So if you start at a random point in space, okay, with random initial conditions, and do this iterative solution, you should converge on a maximum likelihood point. Now, if you converge to a local maximum, so then what you want to do is you want to start from different places and see if you're really arriving at a true maximum or not. And so the degeneracy of the space. When you go up to having 100 states, right, there are presumably many degenerate solutions here. Okay. And so one thing you have to check is whether or not you just unluckily, one fit you ran once, got the bad fit. And then might be better. So the way to take this story here about the increasing problematic, and the increasing problematic because you have more states is to try different solutions. That's the short answer.
Seems like there'd be a lot of attachment points for like your example.
What do you mean?
Like, just suddenly you reach a state where now you're in a bad period of time, and then you're in a good period of time. It's hard to escape. Once you cross the boundary, it's hard to get back. Mm-hmm. But then possible. Mm-hmm. So this structure of this might have clusters that are loosely linked, mm-hmm. like a long road home.
No, I think that's a fair description. And in some sense, if you wanted to make the fugue case work, you might try to have a hierarchy of sort of nested finite state machines, one governing the rhythm, one governing the, you know, the core structure, one governing the smaller scale structure. That would in general require you to have an enormous number of states, because for each superstate, you have all the individual substates within it. So you would need a very large number of states to model that system.
That makes me think of if you, instead of having three non-interacting machines, we have these three different ones, like you just said, that interact with each other in some
That would produce behavior that cannot be modeled by a finite state machine. So that effect is still obscure to me. But I think it's possible if that's how it works. Yes?
If you have a number of states,
yes, you could.
Intuitive, but there's huge group editors and it's complicated, and so you need lots of
Right, and so what that means is that you can't coarse grain. Right? You have to keep all of the microstructure. Right? And there's no good way to coarse grain the microstructural states into larger scale states that give you a simpler machine that you can build an effective field theory for. So the argument you're making there is that the way the system builds itself is in such a way that the theory is non-renormalizable. Yes?
By trying to model the people editing Wikipedia as finding the same machine, are you already sort of coarse grained it down from the sort of universal Turing machine, which we might need?
So that's the sort of second example here, or the second possible answer, which is that the reason it's failing is that there are persistent properties. There are persistent non-finite state machine properties of individuals that stick around when you aggregate them on increasingly larger scales. So when you get a group, just to be clear, that aggregation is divergent, right? Just to be clear, you take all these people, put them in a big group, and now figure out the correct ways to coarse grain the microstates. Somehow, the non-finite state properties of the individuals, okay, frustrate that step. And that's why you're not getting the right answer.
Does it not make the last two the same?
Sorry?
So those last two, are those last test relations the same or not the same?
No. So in the second case here, which was sort of the theory that came up in front of the room, the idea is that you, even though the underlying systems are finite state machines, you can't draw good equivalence classes around them to produce coarse grain states that give an effective theory that works. So in that case, the base structures are all finite state machines. Okay. In the second case there, somehow some sort of non-finite state machine property of humans is percolating up. But the institutions have a complexity that depends upon the individual complexities of the complexity of the individuals.
Imagine we have a time scenario
back piece and what piece?
And what's off?
Oh, Bach and Mozart. Yes, sorry. Yes.
And so the states are the same. And we assume that they are both surfaces are fine state machines.
Okay.
So the states are the same, but the rules evolve at some point.
Yes. Yeah.
Is there a method to recognize where it is the great one? And in order to coarse grain in most different pieces instead of one.
Right. So this is just sort of kind of brought it out. This is the question. Maybe this is a non-equilibrium. That it was finite state in March, and it's finite state in May, but somewhere in between there was a transition between two structures. And I'm sure if one believed there was a discrete transition where it literally swapped over from Bach and Mozart, one could build a Bayesian model, right, where you had two finite state machines that you were fitting plus an additional parameter for it. So it doesn't seem in principle impossible, but I don't know the particular way that's going to attack the problem. Write it down as well. Yes?
What does it mean that the third thing is obscure? Mm-hmm. That you don't know example?
I don't know how to describe a simple system where this happens. So it's obscure to me. I don't have a simple example of how it might happen that kind of trains my intuition.
I want to go back to the beginning because I would like to you to paraphrase the statements you made about this picture. So I have a somewhat different language, but it may help to get a picture somewhat in a different picture. I would say I have a space, okay? These are the 1, 2, 3 ABC. So that's a space. Then I have a group. The group are actions which map one configuration to the other.
Yes.
So the group is not a state space, it is operations only.
Absolutely. Yes.
They are a collection.
Yes.
So let's take three states. I say all possible ways I can do its permutations.
Yep.
Because all states.
Yep.
So there is a fixed group of all permutations.
Yes.
Every permutation is an arrow. I can do the inverse And so I start with my six state machine.
Yes.
And if I talk about that group, I have bidirectional arrows between all of the states. Six states there or something like that.
Yes.
All these arrows. Then I, that's the starting point of completely reversible, trivial machine, if you want to say. Then I have all the double arrows, so I've maximally connected the whole thing.
Yes.
Now you start saying a few things. One is you say, I'm going to subsets of actions, which are again close among each other. For example, you have the board there. I have a cyclic group of three, which maps configuration. So one way to say it is, and I have twofold, that I start erasing arrows. That's the first. So subgroups means you cross out certain arrows that they have to close among subsets of states. So there's
you hide them, let's say.
Yeah.
Hide them under the equivalent.
Tie them like that. Tie them like that. You have three of those equivalents. So that is a question of stretching out arrows in a subset because you are not doing these things.
You're hiding arrows because when
a certain operators in the big group you no longer use.
Right, because
you are looking to a subset of the arrows. But as long as you keep still a group, they are bidirectional. This is what is also important.
Yes.
So then you still have a subgroup. Now you think, okay, you wanted to do the opposite. You said, I draw a six state machine and I draw an operation set of mappings.
Mm-hmm.
And you have that particular example where you get stuck, for example.
Yes.
And then you show it is not invertible.
Yes.
So now, I would say the third step is now the question, can I replace the bidirectional arrows by single directional arrows in your picture in such a way to reproduce that machine? Yes, you can. And since...
Where is this? Hold on a second. What was the last thing you said?
I said, let me say it in all the words. I can all represent these bidirectional arrows as matrices acting on the six dimensions. So see, six matrices. Moving you from one state into the other.
Yes.
Now, there's a group. Groups always have invertible matrices.
Yes.
If it's the inverse, and then the bidirectional arrows.
Yes.
Now you start talking about singles.
Yes. Yes.
Then you
yes.
are making matrices which are, say, upper diagonal. They sit in the top. And
yes.
then they drive you into some subsystem of, of the space, and they stay there.
Yes.
And I think, so that's what you call semi-group
problem. Semi-group, yes.
So you erase certain parts of the arrows. And that is basically, you could say, first you have all possible transition matrices and permutation matrices, then you have a circle bridge, and then you cross out, and you only keep the upper diagonal ones for part of your system. Is that a correct way of proceeding to get at least to the system that you ended up with?
Yes, absolutely, yes.
So it's interesting for me to see now that are you getting matrices which fit you in a subspace? That's kind of very nice to see.
Right. So those these irreversible operations that push you into some subspace you can't get out of by some other operation. Yeah.
So and it's true, upper diagonal matrices are not invertible and all these kind of things. So that is a somewhat different way to describe maybe what you did.
Robert.
So this particular group is usually visualized by actions on a triangle with the labeled vertices. And then this decomposition kind of has a dual in terms of functional coarse grain from rotations and deflections.
Mm-hmm.
Is that just a unique property of this group, or?
It's the equivalent of the permutation group for three objects and the group D3.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's an isomorphism, but it's very accidental.
Yeah, so this is just, it's sort of filling there, right? So it just so happens that these small groups, that this is the permutation, this is the group of permutations on objects, also the group of reflections and rotations on objects, right? When you get to large groups, those overlaps don't happen as much, so you don't get the multiple descriptions as much, but it's easier.
It seems like you could potentially test the large-scale institutional complexity, because you actually have a lot more data than you're actually using, in the sense that you could, say you think that these sort of institutional paradigms are emerging patched version of a website, right? So this is on push, so maybe people, you know, who disagree, they see so many cooperation, so they think that they can't really change, you know, the underlying page or like the sort of tone of the page, so they move to another page. So there's this selection bias. So you have data on other pages that maybe are less controversial. And so if you have some, at least some theory about, you know, how your institution is emerging, I think that you can definitely test this. And there are other social processes where you see the same institutional dynamic. I think one of the best papers written in political science is by Dan Posner, where he looks at population and population thresholds, where you sort of see this emergent, emergent process. And it's not just population size, but it's population size relative to the political arena. So when groups get large enough that they can sort of be mobilized by a political entrepreneur, you see like an increase in maybe the sort of salience of social cleavage between different groups, because political entrepreneurs try to just sort of pick up their group to maybe support their sort of political, their, you know, whereas, so, where, as well, but, so it was a case study of Malawi and Zambia, and they looked at different ethnic groups and different demographic compositions, and they found that in a place where you have larger demographic groups, that they were sort of pitted against each other, so that, you know, each was sort of trying to get political, sort of access to political jobs, whereas in places where you saw much smaller demographic proportions, the salience of political cleavage was much lower, because they were sort of seen as, oh, all of them been to the Northwest province, and they're all trying to just get leadership together. So you really see these emergent processes when you have a sort of demographic change. And so if you have
Let me try to rephrase what you're saying in a computational story. And what I might say is the following, right? So a finite state machine has no memory, right? All the machine remembers is the state is currently, right? And the story you're telling is how populations, in some sense, encode new memories, right? And for example, they might encode memories just in terms of how many people are staking out a particular position, right? And so now, in some sense, they have, in addition to access to your internal state, you also have access to this sort of memory, okay? Which you might describe as a push on top of, right? And so now, in some sense, the machines are getting access to a new computational property, which is the ability to store some number, right? Some bit of data in a larger system and access it. And so what that would do is give you a new set of computational powers that you weren't able to do. So I think that's the story. And the story you're telling about somebody comes along and they see that there's a huge number of cooperations going on. What they're doing is they're accessing the memory of the system, right? They're not simply examining their internal state to see what to do, right? They're also looking at the history. And by accessing the history, that's something the finite state machine by definition doesn't have. And so I guess what I'm trying to do there is just trying to tie that particular story to something that Chris Moore could then formalize, right? And say, okay, so that's what you can do. Maybe there's a stack. Right, there's a library where you can put things on top of the set. Yes, David.
One other kind of question. So, kind of pop science notion of emergence, where you know you have a system that exhibits behaviors that are somehow, the whole is more than the sum of its parts. That would seem to end up as the third category of explanations there, which you seem to be very hesitant to really engage much with, in the sense that you still have a. You don't have an example of a system that has clearly exhibits that type of behavior, or a symbol, I guess.
I don't have a way to make a mathematical model that shows that what I'm saying there makes sense. Like, I can write the sentence, but I don't, mathematically, I can't write it down. We think this stuff has to be true, right? We don't think that even though presumably some clever person could make a Turing-complete machine using sodium-potassium ions in the neuron, we don't think that it's that property that boils up and gives us, you know, the abilities we have as thinking humans. We somehow think in that case, the neurons are pretty simple to bargain. Physicists are criticized for pushing this to an extreme, but even biologists would say, right, that a neuron is not, the computational properties of the human are not simply the computational properties of a single neuron. So presumably this kind of emergent whole greater than sum of the parts, right, which catches out as whole has novel computational properties compared to the computational properties of the individuals, right? Individuals, finite state machines, whole context-free language, right? That's something that you want to have a description of. I don't have a description of it yet. Somebody might.
So would it be oversimplifying the Wikipedia question to say, rephrase it as, is there a finite state machine which can produce a power law? Yes.
And I think the answer is no. Isn't the question X? And I said, yes, the question is X, and the answer to X is no. I don't think
if I didn't say it. Is it too simple to say that?
Oh, is it too simple to say that? So is the question not X? No, the question is. No, so sorry, let me search. So what you're saying is, I think what you're really saying, and you said it very well, is the following. Okay, what is this really telling us?
Yeah.
Right? I mean, can we really draw all these massive conclusions on this slide from the failure of this fit? Right? Can we really say that's what's going on? And I think the answer is yes. And so that means maybe, right? So I think the answer is yes in the sense that these are well-defined objects, right? A finite state machine has certain mathematical properties you can't violate, right? So for example, it's a semigroup, right? Or it models a semigroup. So if a semigroup has a certain property, then a finite state machine has to have a certain property, right? So these systems are well-defined mathematically, and so if you can find something that if A, then B, okay? So if finite state machine, therefore exponential cutoff, and no exponential cutoff, that implies no finite state machine. So it's a mathematical argument, right? But we're talking about mathematical objects. Yes?
I don't know about this particular power law.
Sorry?
But I have an example where this intuition, I think, would be right. And that is if you have an AR1 process.
Okay.
Or if files are between 0 and 1, so it's stationary, a short memory.
Uh-huh.
But if the files are drawn from a beta distribution, then you get a power law decay, even though...
The files, what are the files?
Well, xt is equal to 5 times xt minus 1 plus xt.
Okay.
So you can show that the short memory process for each single moment, but if you draw the files, as you move a long time, from a beta distribution,
uh-huh.
and you average out the beta distribution of the whole process,
uh-huh.
then this is a long memory hyperbolic. So I don't know how this translates into the...
That's a very good point. We should talk afterwards, because it's...
It could be, for example, that at every moment, every day we can be there,
uh-huh.
we have an explanation of this issue.
Uh-huh.
But just everyone has their own lambda.
Uh-huh.
And then if you average up them like this.
Oh, so you're averaging over exponential scale power laws?
Well, for the time series, I know it works. I don't know if it works.
Yeah, so we should talk afterwards, because my intuition is, it's not something I prove. My intuition is that this exponential cutoff is generic for finite state machines. But we should absolutely talk. Tom, you say there are non-Tom questions briefly, and please talk about it.
Okay, I may have just been thinking what Georg just said, but I just don't understand what Georg was saying to you. But I'd like to propose a state machine with, let's say, 100 states. So at one, let's say at the top you have a dispute, okay? And then going down you have an arrow to every subsequent contribute. So you just have a long string, so contribute one,
yep.
contribute two. Now, then once you're at contribute one, you have a probability of going back up to dispute. It's a very high probability. Then, so you have a list of arrows going down, and then each contribute has one arrow going back up to dispute.
Mm-hmm.
So would that not produce a power law if you just decrease the probability that you have to return? Eventually, you're going to return.
Let me give you two answers to that.
Yeah.
One is maybe, because I can't think it through on the stage. The other is what you're doing is you're fitting, sort of mentally fitting a model to the system, right? And one thing we can do is say, is the likelihood of that model, right? Is the likelihood of that model less or greater than the model we have here, the model of the machine learning algorithm found? And it may be the case that you're able to fit one thing very well, but then I might be able to pull up a different graph and show that fit rates very badly on the other one. So what you're doing is a very good idea, which is trying to figure out, okay, how general is that exponential decay? Can you make a machine that has that very nice property, right? And then at the same time, you're competing with a machine learning algorithm, right? Because it's able to search that space pretty well. That's not a very satisfactory answer, but it's also a very good suggestion. It's something I can think about. I don't know what the answer is. So it sounds a little like some of the exponentials, which is maybe what's going on. So anyway, yeah, absolutely. Thank you very much.
I think we should close the session.